My name is Paul Bruce. I'm a lowly developer evangelist at a company called Perfecto Mobile, and we provide a cloud lab, a platform to be able to pull in real devices into your development workflows, into your continuous delivery process, and so on and so forth. So we've got a booth. If you haven't already been, I've noticed a number of faces that have already been there, so thank you for that. But in the meantime, I'd like to keep this to the topic at hand, which is Espresso. So first off, just to level set a bit, to me, Espresso represents a fundamentally different way to approach the work that we do on a platform that constantly changes. Would you tend to agree? Who's done any sort of UI testing before? Okay. Some of the people in the room have not. So this is a good mixed crowd of people who may not have been exposed to certainly Espresso or even UI testing. And so when you get to UI testing, right, that's a pretty complicated space. And so Espresso to me represents a change in the way that we actually ship software, that we deliver on the fragmented Android platform. For the folks in the room that typically do unit testing and don't spend much time in UI testing, what this really means is that you're able to reliably ship software that works, right? And to ship tests that validate that, and to improve a process, which is typically after it leaves your workstation, it goes somewhere else and is built on a server somewhere, to have that process be a consistent process. And so Espresso allows us to do these things. We'll get into code. We'll get into that stuff. But in the meantime, I just want to say Espresso is awesome because of that. So I'm a big fan of Espresso for those reasons. So zooming out a bit, this is just a simplified view of what the conversation will revolve around today, which is how does Espresso fit into the normal set of activities, and particularly in the scope of feedback that we need in order to ship software faster. And so I think Espresso is a new way of essentially dealing with a key problem, which is not a new problem at all, particularly for developers. It's time. UI testing takes time from our budget in code. And so at the very least, right, show of hands, who has done unit testing before? Come on. Yes. All right. So this is by default, we ship a lot of unit tests. We write a lot of unit tests, right? But one of the anti-patterns that I see, and even going on to Google Best Practices, who's also seen the testing pyramid, the unit tests at the bottom, integrations in the middle, and UI tests, and it's to provide a view of how much time you should spend on what types of tests, 70% unit tests, and another percentage, and it kind of varies per organization, per project. But ultimately, there are different types of tests for different reasons. And so if we think about the scope of unit tests, they test things like code modules, classes, methods, basic code. We all know this, right? If we move past that, what we're doing in integration testing is testing the interactions between systems and the configuration between those systems. And then as we get into UI testing, we're actually testing the interactions that go on in application to application. That's especially something unique about Espresso, particularly through intents. But the idea is that unit tests are great, fantastic. I'm glad you're writing them. They don't catch everything. In fact, they catch a very narrow set of issues. But they do that really fast. So that's why we write a lot of them. It's because it catches the most obvious things right up front. Really tests that run at the code level, really only in isolation of things like real user conditions and platform specifics, that's a problem. Because the world that we live in and the world that the user lives in is an ecosystem that contains those problems. And so we need to figure out a way to pull in some of that reality into what we do. So the next step is, right, of course, integration tests. But that's usually not the point of integration tests. That's really just hooking systems up together. That's what that covers. So when we get to integration tests, again, the problem still remains that they only capture a narrow slice of the ultimate problems that your users are going to experience on the fragmented variety of platforms that are out there. And so now we can do UI testing. And if you think about, aside from the wrapping issue, the who particularly these tests are for, who benefits from a test that tells them whether something worked or not at that level, unit tests, that's mostly the development team, that's developers. Right? If you think about the integration test, that's far more like the architecture, making sure that the architecture is plugged together properly and configuration is right. When you think about UI tests, who benefits from that the most? Is that the end user? They don't see it. Hopefully they don't see flaws. Hopefully they don't see unless they're caught by UI tests. But it's not necessarily the developer. Ultimately, if there's a problem, it'll come back to people who are going to fix it. But really, the perspective of the UI test is from the business. It's particularly to satisfy what the key workflow was that they were trying to build out and to put out to the world. And so there's different perspectives that these things are written in. And Espresso kind of is sort of the strange little love child of like a unit and UI test. It's got certain components of the language allow you to do isolation and to be a little bit more hermetic in how you work with the platform. So we'll get into that. But it's certainly not a unit test. The idea is that you should be able to validate the interface quickly, right? And also to mitigate the problems of the platform, the sticky details of actually working with a variety of platforms. It emphasizes that the isolation of data and streams coming in and interdependencies at the platform level. So this allows us to avoid a lot of aspects of test flakiness, which is pretty cool. So I work with multiple groups that use all sorts of different testing frameworks, and one of the other ones that I'll talk about is Appio. And we'll go through kind of some of the differences between them. Hopefully by the end of this you'll kind of see why I'm such a nutcase for Espresso. So, you know, I drunk the Kool-Aid with Espresso, because who doesn't like this kind of person? But I know a lot of hardcore testers. In my practice, I talk with a lot of like SDEVs and development engineers. And the thing is, that's not who I think should be validating that your ship works. If you're going to build something, it's you. It's not somebody else's problem to make sure it works, right? Because ultimately we're trying to make stuff that delights people. And so when you start to take ownership over that process, now all of a sudden, it's important to make sure that something works not just when it leaves your desk, but also when you change things. And you need to make sure that that thing that you shipped last week works as well. So automated testing, particularly automated testing, is an important responsibility when you start to take ownership over that experience. So the thing that I say sometimes is like developers that don't think about the user first are kind of a thing of the past at this point. So these are my opinions. I'm going to get off my soapbox at this point. But this is really not about me, and this is, yes, about Espresso, but it's really more about you and your craft. And I want to at least provide each of you something that you didn't know before you started the session. And so that's why I've decided to mini-series it. So I've got a couple of little episodes here that I'm actually going to ask you to vote on, say, which should we do first? In what order should we do this? So if you want to take out your phones, the CD underbelly of Espresso is about the gory details of how Espresso works, particularly in ADB and the bug bridge. How Espresso is like Green Lantern's ring is my satire. It's a little lightweight sort of, you know, jokes. And then also Espresso in code is a couple code examples for those of you who are new to it. So let's do that right now. If you can take out your phones and go to that URL up there, I'll give you a few moments. And it'll give you an opportunity to kind of drag and drop which ones work.
Yeah. Are the slides posted anywhere?
They will be, yes. And you know what? I'll hashtag in that fun out with my slides. Yeah. So when you get this up, whether it's on your phone or your computer or whatever, it gives you the opportunity to sort of drag and drop. Does everybody see that so far? Anybody still trying to log in or anything? Anybody stuck there? A little surprised, does everybody know who Green Lantern is? He's a comic book character.
Called ADB or
into an APK, your app APK. An APK server will first put that and also will separate your test step into a separate APK. And it will send it to the device. And then the APK client on the device will then start to interact with the server. And so what will happen is your app will launch and your test, which technically is its own application as well, will launch on top of that, but it will use on the device itself, both of those things are running, separate threads, and the runner will actually kick off the tests and will use something called instrumentation. We'll talk about that in a while too. Instrumentation to basically broker the details of what's going on inside your app to the tests themselves. And this is really important, and we'll get into that in code later. But just this is the high level sort of sketchy architecture that I could sketch up on the plane on the way over. So that's high level. If you see ADB, when we see this actually working in Android Studio, and there's gory details underneath there, that's what's happening. This is the interaction format. And so what I mean by instrumented is like when you go to the doctor and you get the probe stuck on you, it's measuring certain aspects of your body as you are doing something, as you are going through, let's say, a stress test. And so by instrumentation, how that differs from another framework is that if you don't have instrumentation, how does that framework even know that the button is done being clicked or that the view doesn't have additional activities that are still waiting on the message queue? Was that over the top? Does everybody know what I mean by like a message queue in the main UI thread? There's stuff that still has to occur in your app, but if your tests don't know about that and they just keep going on and on, then that becomes a problem because now all of a sudden your tests fail even though your app is still working properly, just a little bit slower than yesterday. So that's why instrumentation is important here, but also because it provides a way to get information about your app and to broker those details on your sheet. So I just want to kind of show you what that's like in Android Studio real quick. Who else in the room? Did anybody attend Jason's session? All right. did this at least 6 times this morning, just to make sure it wasn't slow. And it's still slow. Wow. All right. Well, I'm not going to waste our time here. But the idea, yes, I am. So once that's finished, you see a bunch of ADD commands push the APK out to the device and then start to interact. And what you'll see, there you go, is that it launches on the device. Now, this is just an aside. This device is in Wakefield in Boston area, Massachusetts. It's actually got a bunch, it's a real device in the data center with a cell SIM card in it, so it's got a data plane and stuff. So you can interact with the device. The point is, you can go around the app and mess around with it. Pretty straightforward. But under the sheets, what it's doing is it's providing this information about what's going on back to your IDE. So between these layers is a layer of information that is going on. And that's very different from the way that other test frameworks work. I've mentioned multiple test frameworks. This is WebDriver. Who else uses WebDriver in the room? Anyone? Selenium? Web testing? A few people. And so this is more like how that works. While what happens is you write a script over on your local client or on some, and that runs from one client, right, some machine. And on that machine, there's a controller and a command client, a little like that server and client model with the ADD bridge. But it sends commands to a command server on the device. It doesn't give the tests in their entirety to that device or run them inside the threads at all. One step at a time, Appium interacts with the device in order to engage with it. And so as you might tell, who has integrated with APIs in there, like a web API, sends JSON, okay. So quite a few mobile developers have to use APIs, not surprising. But it's a lot like that, like when you're sending very small commands across the network, and you're doing that way too much, it gets really slow, right? So the number of transactions that you send back and forth can potentially cause speed issues. And so it's a similar thing with WebDrive. As awesome as that the team that has built Appium, I love that team. I love that technology in the sense that it is good for a certain type of testing. If you've got a hybrid app or if you want to write the same tests for multiple platforms, fine. But in the meantime, it suffers from having to send commands one at a time across the bridge in such a way, especially with the remote WebDriver, that's really slow. So I already had two people in conversations at the Perfecto booth yesterday where we mentioned, as soon as I mentioned Appium, they go, it's so slow. And that's problematic in the build cycle on your local machine, and it's really problematic when you're doing that a lot in CI server. So I don't have to be agnostic about which one I like more. But in the meantime, if we can break down like the pros and the cons of an instrumented framework, I'm just going to use Appium as the static, the core example. But Espresso, fast to execute. It's really fast. And even with some of the inefficiencies of the ADB transport model, it's still far faster than Appium. Object locators, we'll talk about that in a second, but essentially your object locators, like your resource file, it's all the same code that your app uses. So inheriting that context is really useful for tests, as opposed to Appium, which oftentimes you have to relegate down to either storing your IDs of your controls somewhere else, and that's not in your app. That's actually in a separate script. So you have to manage those IDs, and those IDs change, your development changes IDs. Now all of a sudden, you have to change your test libraries and your page object models and stuff. It begs breakage to have tests completely separate from your application, or test code, I should say. And so The upgrade time for Espresso, minimal. How many people love upgrading Android Studio? Maybe one hand. I'll talk to you later. But the problem is, like, if you actually use Appium and not just use it in like a dinky little, like, oh, I'm just going to try it today, you actually try to put it in production and you try to scale it out and you try to put it on your build server and you try to have your full dev team. I don't know how many people have more than like 5 devs on their team. We deal with a lot of enterprises. And so we're talking about dev teams that are literally like dozens and dozens. I think one of the largest teams that I worked with was upwards of 100 devs that are on their broad mobile platform portfolio. And so the problem is, when you perpetuate Appium around the organization, it's another piece of the infrastructure that you have to maintain. And so upgrading this can be problematic. And why are you upgrading Appium so often? Because if you think back about a month ago, iOS 10 came out and broke Appium. It's still broken right now. It still doesn't run under a number of key conditions and considerations. And so you're kind of left in the lurch until the community fixes it, or you, by the way, contribute something that fixes it. And so Espresso, on the other hand, when they ship a new version of something, more than likely, and this is their history, is that they will ship updates to Espresso. It doesn't happen all that often. It doesn't happen because they did a pretty good job on the sheets making Appium API compatibility, I think. But ultimately, the upgrade time is minimal on one, whereas it's like you can spend a whole day trying to upgrade Appium in just your dev team. It's not just a one-click process. Also, flakiness, for a number of reasons, it's a lot lower in Espresso, just common knowledge. You can always write a really flaky test no matter what you use, but for the most part, the pattern incentivizes you to write a very stable test. In Appium, it really depends. It really is, there is a couple problems, one of which is copy and paste. Everybody loves copy and paste. And so you see some script that says, hey, it's going to work if you copy and paste from Stack Overflow. That has a bunch of sleeps in it. We'll talk about why those are devilish. But ultimately, it suffers from the copy and paste play. So I would say one of the only things that Appium really just wins out on Espresso, and I don't know how much it matters to this group, is you can do cross-platform testing. So you can write a test that essentially runs on multiple platforms, in theory. In practice, not so much. Because guess what? iOS likes to be different than Android and vice versa. User experiences are different. So there's many times where teams will, even using Appium, that could go cross-platform, don't. They write separate scripts for individual platforms, and they only benefit from the fact that the whole team writes on the same language. But it's not optimized to that language. Just like Espresso is native, really very native to Android, there is a correlative, there is a companion on the iOS side. I know that there are a number of people, was it Jessica? I was talking to you and you came from an iOS background? Okay. So there are a number of people here who are just like hardcore only Android devs. So that would be, on the iOS side, that would be XE test. It's really coming up as sort of a companion, an equal citizen on the iOS side, and Espresso is on Android. So now that we've sort of talked about some of the details, the pros and cons, I want to step back a bit and really mention that the goal here, the goal of all of this, is to get fast feedback, but not just fast feedback. Yeah, that's pretty fast feedback. But also useful feedback. So what good does a broken test do to anybody? Like if you get results from a test that failed, now all of a sudden you're trying to track that down, but it's not actually, it's like a red herring, it's like a test is flaked and so it failed, and that's not really useful data. So fast information, fast feedback, is only good when it is useful feedback. And if you think about actually the challenges here in the ecosystem, there's a number of conditions that like even the most well-written Espresso test don't necessarily catch. So things like memory issues, battery life issues, there's a discussion going on about battery life right now. Please don't mass exodus, I'm just saying. It's a thing, right? Like Facebook think it's, I was talking to one of the other conference speakers, and he said that he went out to Facebook the other last month, and they were talking to him about how like one out of every 20 builds of their mobile app has to go to a separate testing run that specifically tests what the impact on battery life is, because that's how important it is. So that's not just it, right? That's not just the only resources. There are things like interruptions, resource conflicts. One of the financial institutions that we were talking with, they were one of the first people to have a check capture feature. How cool is that? Like, take a picture and check. I mean, you know, I'm not from the 80s, so I think anything that isn't wired to the phone is still the wall is still pretty awesome. But the check capture feature was failing for a significant portion of their market. It was like upwards of 20%. And the idea is that they would have to troubleshoot this incident from production. And it wasn't touching on emulators. It wasn't failing on emulators for them. It wasn't failing on their local devices, their local lab devices. And so it was really hard to figure out what it was. And as it turns out, what it was Instagram. The Instagram app was holding on to the camera behind the scenes, and so when their users were actually trying to do a check capture, now all of a sudden there was resource conflict. Like, they weren't testing for it. They had no way to test for it. And so then it was failing for those people. And so they were in alert to try to figure that out. Once they figured it out, then they were able to write their app to handle that exception. But they didn't at first. There's also things like push notifications. There might be a few things. You could actually talk to Jason. He referenced it in his session on Tuesday. But there are a couple things you might be able to do to sort of eke by with faking out push notifications. But in reality, that's some of the stuff that end users go through. There's constant distraction away from your app on the platform. And so the idea is, Espresso doesn't necessarily deal with all these realities. This is reality. This is the ecosystem that end users live in. So Espresso isn't necessarily, can really undermine not only the quality of your app, not only your happiness, but also the speed at which you move on to the next thing. And so that's why I say, like, when faced with reality, what do we do? Right? We've got a shit ton of work to do. So do we actually incorporate some of those challenges in? Do we run away from them? Or do we say, bring it on? Bring it on. And if we run away from them, what happens is we are now getting away from how our app works in the real world. And so what we end up doing is signing off on code that is inherently broken for our audience. We don't mean to, but we do. And so what we need to do is introduce these things early and more often. So the idea is we want to spend less time on rework, and not just design rework, because that's hard enough to figure out. That's more of a planning outcome. But specifically defects. I hate defects so much. And it's because I see defects undermine not the quality of the app, but the velocity of the teams that we work with. And so as soon as those teams can start to spend less time dealing with issues that came from a previous sprint into the new one, like as soon as they can start to get over that hump, now they have more time to work on new one, on new features. And to see that transformation happen is awesome, but it takes a number of key components to do that. So it's one thing to say, well, we should spend less time on new. Okay. But in reality, it really does boil down to this. If you can spend more time, less time on defects, you have more time for new stuff. So my suggestion is, and this is just anecdotal, this is kind of just a cookie cutter recipe, and this would be customized to your situation. But the idea is, if you think about the different activities that go along, like your local builds in your own environment, when you merge, and then that gets built on a CI server, and then maybe in a separate schedule, a nightly or a regression test, if you think about the different tests that you might do across those, the question becomes, how do we test the UI? And it requires either a simulated environment or some kind of hardware to do that. And so in your local build, obviously, if you're running your own unit tests, fantastic. But also, if you're writing UI tests, you want to be running those locally, obviously, before you commit them. And then in the merge to build, typically that will be your integration tests in a build verification step. And you might introduce some key smoke tests. A couple of things that are just like, look, if this isn't working, we don't want to bother moving forward with that. How many people work with a system like Jenkins or have a pipeline? Okay, and what about specifically in Jenkins, the pipeline code? Have you gotten to that yet? To write pipeline code? That's relatively new. It was at Jenkins World a couple months ago, and all the release engineers and devs were starting to freak out about how awesome that is. So I would recommend taking a look at that. But in the meantime, when you're building that out, you got to think about, like, well, what happens if I just use, for instance, the intents. Intents are something that you can actually mock out some data that's coming into your app or being asked from your app out into the system, like a camera screenshot. And so on a local build, we don't want to have to do all that, like, very specific hardware stuff. That will take more time. So we might mock out some of that stuff. But I put API down here because I know how important it is to the mobile development cycle, is that we're dealing with web APIs, right? Web APIs. And so typically you'd use like static data instead of calling out to that API. You might lock it out. But when you're going into the CI process, if you merge and then that builds, now all of a sudden it becomes that you probably want to use like a mock server or some kind of virtual API or virtualization, service virtualization. And then on the full nightly, what we're dealing with is a full run of all the tests. So I'm assuming that people have probably already, you know about regression testing. Who doesn't know about regression testing? It's okay. Okay. So for the most part, there's maybe one or two people. But the idea is, like, it's a final safety net at the end of your process. Unfortunately, if you think about defects, the longer you leave them unaccounted for and unresolved, the harder they are to resolve, the longer they take to resolve. And so with a safety net at the very end, just before, like, hey, you're going to release that version, the problem is if you're running all those tests and you're catching defects there, that's really problematic because then you have to fix them on the last minute, right? How many people have done that, right? White knuckle, last minute, damn that regression suite. But it's a good thing to catch those things. I was at a major financial institution a couple months ago. I was at the table with the Android commercial app team. And the conversation went, it was between the release manager and their lead developer on the team. And I asked the release manager, how often do you release? And he laughed. And I was like, oh, there's a clue. There's something there. And he laughed and he said, hey, when are we going to release? And he pointed over to the lead developer. And the lead developer said, well, we were supposed to today. But we caught stuff in regression, and it's going to be Monday before we can actually, because they have to rerun the regression suite. Think about it. When you catch stuff in regression, you've got to fix it. And generally, you've got to rerun some, if not all, of that regression suite again for final confidence. And so if you can catch the problems earlier, and that's the whole point of doing different types of tests earlier, quicker, faster feedback, that helps you get there. So if we think about the hardware involved, and there's a place, time and place, certainly for emulators, absolutely, like on the plane, on a train, when you're just doing quick builds, that's fine for a local build, but when you start to put that into your CI process, those can be very flaky. After a while, after 30 hours, they just stop working, memory issues, and Android, the Android team is really trying to resolve those issues, and a lot of issues with emulators have come down in the years, but there's still plenty of them. And so, when you actually get to that full nightly regression, it might take 4 hours, 2, 4, 6 hours, or so on and so forth, that becomes really problematic because there are tests that have to run longer than that emulator can handle. And so that's really not, to me, the emulation of full nightly regression is less of an option. We think about a local lab. Who has a local pool of devices that are like a shared pool of devices? A couple folks, okay? How about half the room? Do you also have devices that are plugged into your machine? Yes, right? So we have devices everywhere. And the question is, how many devices do we need to match our target audience? And the problem with local labs, when you start, like in the local build, maybe you have those devices available to you or somebody else, or you reserve them. And that might work. But when it comes to your CI process, now all of a sudden, that doesn't scale very well. Because now you're in the business of managing this rolling set of devices that change nonstop. And so what we do is we actually, one of the things Perfecto provides for free is a digital coverage, test coverage index. And it gives you sort of breakdown of how once a quarter we update that so that you kind of know what are the most important platforms to target. And we partnered recently with a company called Appian to get even more data in that report so that you kind of, that's free. So I would check that out and I can send a link out as well. But it really helps you kind of set the reality and say, well, I know my local builds, I use emulators, that's fine. But if we're going to make people happy, what are these people? What is the audience really like? And maybe for some people, it's like 5 or 6 major platforms, that's what we can do. But for other people, it's upwards of 10 to 15 different platforms that they have to test on. So that becomes even more problematic when you're building nonstop all day long, even with your key smoke tests, even if your local lab only handles the key smoke tests. And then certainly in nightly regression, that's problematic. And so that's why many people turn to a cloud lab, which is there's reliability, there's scalability, there's those kind of things, and you're not having to manage those devices. You've sort of gotten back to the work that you're supposed to do, you know, that you're there for. So you're not constantly managing a set of devices. And so when we talk about like tests and where they run and when they run, how do you actually figure out how to run certain tests at some time and other tests at another? And Espresso has the concept of annotations. So these are little things that you can annotate. Most people are nodding their heads, so you know what annotation is on a method. I'm going to show you. But if you think about like fitting this into a development cadence, right? Like on a local build, maybe we just want to mark one test and just like run it and go and figure out what the heck's going on. We can do that either by right-clicking and creating an entirely new configuration, or we can slap an annotation on it and have a configuration already set up and just press the play button. So that's one option. But the idea is there's a couple of different ways that you might split the tests out. That could be based on components, or I would call them, some people call them modules. The idea is if you want to test all your list functionality based on a specific custom component, right? If you want to go through all the tests that use those, you have to annotate those tests, but then you can rerun those when you know that you just messed or that you're worried about how that might mess things up. Same thing with maybe your mainstream release versus what you're working on next. So if you want to mark some of these things with these annotations, it doesn't require you to only ever run them that way. It just gives you a little metadata around your test to say kind of this is the pool of tests that I want to shove this into. And they're not mutually exclusive. I'll show an example. But the workflows are also things like, hey, the whole sign-up process. Because there might be individual tests for individual screens that are all contributing to that workflow, and you might not want to have one big long test that tests the entire thing. Same thing with like checking balances or validating information on your account. And so another one is by persona. If you've got specific users that use your app and you know their pattern of use, you might actually create specific personas and start tagging your tests based on that. And then there's a couple of other examples, like just an arbitrary, hey, if the business says this is a key test that we need to validate, just put a key smoke test on it or something like that. So on the other side, so flip over to an example. I've got a couple of basic examples here. The link in front of my mouse cursor. There we go. So this test is, there's a couple of tests in this class. Let me actually hard to see. How's that? Any better? So in this case, what we have is we have a class that has a couple of Espresso tests. And this is a test I purposely wrote to describe how a seek bar is problematic unless you write some custom stuff. And then also a test down here that resolves that with a custom action. On top of that, There's an element called app test, and that's a required element if you want to use the Android JUnit runner for Espresso tests. But then on top of that, I have annotated these with different annotations. So right now, I've just marked this as the thing that if I want to run it in a set of tests that I'm just working on right now or a specific set of workflows, and I can use this locally. I can basically just arbitrarily mark some of these tests as stuff that I care about, like in this commit cycle, that I can do that. That's an idea. But also, if this is a longer term sort of thing that we know for sure wants to be rerun as part of our build verification, then we can tag that way. I mean, it's kind of up to you. Be creative. Don't be too creative. You know, talk with the team about sort of the pattern that you want to use in order to go beyond your local workstation. I've got the annotations actually look like this. I've got them in a separate little package here. This is simply just a class that has a couple of decorators on that, and it allows you to use that in later code. So just by defining this here, I can go ahead and use that here. For instance, there's a search workflow over there, very easy. Intelligence automatically works. So if this was part of the search workflow, I would just go and bang it in there, and then it should run. So when I actually run the active debug, there are other ones that might be also involved. And so you would also catch those tests. Does that make sense to everybody? It's just an easy way to like put metadata around what the heck the test is about, context on it, so that you can use that later. And back to the line. You're on the other one. So just a couple of patterns, and everything that I've said here, again, just like anything, is a hypothesis in the sense that it can be improved upon. So I would encourage you to reach out to me afterward and say, this is actually how we customize our tests. This is how we annotate our tests. Because that's good feedback for me as somebody who kind of goes around and talks, and I can share that with other people. So any interest in sharing? So my current research right now is, if you think about the cycle in which we do our work, we're constantly contributing to a local commit. And then when we hit that commit up to the server, when we do that, do a PR, or if we push it, the idea is, how does a build server know that there are a couple of tests you just incorporated? Not all of the tests, just the new ones that you created within that commit, or within a commit since a certain particular time. And so that's kind of an important thing that I've seen in a number of teams, and they haven't resolved that. And so I'm in the process of essentially building a custom runner, and I would love your feedback on this too, if you're interested. A custom runner that you can actually put in your build process that will automatically pick up which new tests are being committed and run just those. And the importance of that is you don't want to incorporate flaky tests. You don't want to incorporate tests that only work on your machine into the main branch. If you're working on a separate feature branch and you've committed that stuff, it should run, but it should back those changes out if your tests are failing in a different environment. Does that make sense? Yeah. Because, I mean, like, flaky tests don't do anybody any good. So in this sense, the idea is as you build, you're adding new tests before you commit. It should, you should, of course, locally should run those new tests yourself, annotations or whatever. But after that push, the CI process should be able to run those new tests, just those new tests. And if or when they fail, it should send you back something typically like this. And then on the success, it typically just merge some math. Anybody seen the tool GitK? One or two people are nodding yes. I would suggest just taking a quick look at that. That's a value that I can provide you today. Simply just a reference to, hey, by the way, check this out. This is awesome. This is a really cool thing. It visualizes the branches and how you're merging them. And, so, once I get past this part of my research, I'm going to probably take a look at KK and see if there's a way to actually incorporate when an entire branch gets merged. What was the delta? What was the difference? And run those tests. So that's like a level up. That's a little bit more than just your personal commit to a specific branch. But that's what I'm working on right now. So the next step is I'm going to skip past some of these and get right into the code. How am I doing on time, everybody?
I got 23 minutes.
Excellent. Okay. So remember this. This was the pattern. I highly recommend actually going and getting, it's called the Espresso cheat sheet, printing that out in version 2 tuner. But like literally printing that out, yes, using paper, and putting that right into your desk while you are, if you're new to Espresso, just so that you can have that reference ready to go. That's a really good reference. And so the easiest way to get started, if you are new to this, is, quite frankly, just use the Espresso test recorder. Now, I'm not a big fan of automatically generated test code. Okay, like, I don't like that for a number of reasons. But what this does is it sets up, because it's a first-party citizen in the IDE, it knows how to set up a couple of key things for you, like where to stick the instrument to the UI test, the Espresso test. It creates the folder for you. It also adds the Espresso libraries to your Gradle file, which, quite frankly, when I was first starting, was a constant source of pain. I was using example code from other people with mismatching libraries, mismatching Gradle versions. So that was problematic. So just use the recorder, and with your project, it'll put the right dependencies in there for you. So just a quick there. So if you think about that find, act, and check model, that comes out with a number of different things. I've highlighted a couple things here because it's important enough. So the on view, right? If we think about how we identify elements in our application, it's really great that we get that resource file that's a dynamically generated file based on how you've identified your elements in your layouts. It's really cool. It automatically generates so that now in code, you can actually use autocomplete to use the right element names. This is not something that happens with Appian. This is not something that happens with test frameworks that are outside of the context of your app. And so this is really useful and easy. And guess what? If you change, for whatever reason, you change the property that you're identifying the view object, for whatever reason, if you change that in your test, guess what? It's going to break your test. And you'll be able to see that right up front. You don't necessarily see that right up front when you're using XPath and some other. That's really cool. Gives you really fast feedback about what you just broke and how you need to go fix certain tests. So in this case, there's the R identifier. And also on view, there's the all of is actually all of and the not over there come from a library called Handcrest. So it's, there's built into Espresso, built into some of the libraries there. There's the ability to not only match something, but to use classes that allow you to do simple operations like match all of these elements, all of these matchers together. So this requires that you have a with ID and is displayed. And is displayed is one of those the assertions. So the idea is, if I just go with ID, it might be there, but it might not be displayed. So if I want to actually make sure that that's displayed, I would include multiple matchers there, or multiple assertions there. That's one way to do it. So I would, you know, the viewMatchers is a class, and just press the dot, you get all the reference, so we won't go through that. When it comes to act, that's the perform, so it's typically it's on view, and like the Fluent API example here, you notice how it's broken out into number, but it's very nice, concise, and straightforward syntax. And so, similar thing, You can do a single action, you can do multiple actions by comma. That's pretty nice because sometimes you need to click on an element for it to become ready state, whatever that element is. Sometimes people like to do that. And then it also does a number of other sort of system actions like back, forward, swipe up, down, left, right. You can also do those kind of things as well, so that's kind of cool. And then when it comes to checking it, again, with the what you have to do is say .check. But not just dot check and then the view action, you have to say matches. And so with the matches, you can now combine that with the Handcrest operator, the not operator, that's the function. And then be able to combine these things. So if it's not displayed, if something is not possible as well. So you can also match, you can check to make sure that something has text in it, and one or two code examples I have here will do that. So like I said, this is the world that I live in, is that there's multiple test frameworks out there. The world isn't just Espresso code, right? So the difference between the syntax, and this is an example of WebDriver. As you notice, we didn't have anything in some of the tests earlier that talk about like capabilities of the device. It doesn't get involved in how to appropriate the device. Espresso doesn't. Espresso just expresses a test about a view or about a specific hermetic activity or interaction. Whereas WebDriver has to include a whole bunch of other information about how to run the test as well. So this is kind of like test harness plus the test code as well. So it's a little bit more verbose, if you will. It's been around for a long time. And this is what I was talking about, an issue, what I call sleep creep, which is because other frameworks don't have that instrumentation layer, don't wait for the UI thread to complete what it's doing, what do? How do you resolve that? And most people just go, I'm just going to wait for 3 seconds. I'll click the thing and I'll wait for 3 seconds, and then I'll move on to the next thing. Why is that bad? Anyone want to guess? It adds to test length. That's yes. What else is bad about that?
Never know if that's going to be long enough.
What happens if it takes 4 seconds today? I don't know. The API wasn't working properly. Now all of a sudden, your test fails, even though your app is just fine. In reality, it's a little slow. The problem with this is it's arbitrary. It has no connection to reality. Okay. So, what was your name? Yes. Come on. So, you got that totally right. Execution speed. There's a lot of wasted time. If you think about how quickly UI usually comes back on a good day, you're still having to wait the extra 2.5 seconds or more, you know, 3 second wait or something only took half a second. And that adds to the total length. So when I talked about copy and paste problems earlier, it's because code like this off of Stack Overflow is just, it's copied, and people don't know about this, and then that gets sort of, that it creeps into their code base, and now becomes this arbitrary thing. There are ways around that with WebDriver. You have to create your own custom, essentially what they've done with Espresso, which is to listen for what's happened, but it's more of like a polling mechanism. It has to look at the UI until there's a timeout. That's kind of ugly. So the other thing is what Jason said, which was, you know, the tests become flaky when the timeout elapses. So that's really problematic. And my point is, it's not based on reality. How do you set those numbers? Who set them? Who put numbers in the sleep? You did. Not the users. Not how they actually interact with the app. That's based on not reality. So I don't like that. The other issue here, like I said earlier, is XPath. XPath is a string. You might be able to sponge your way into, like, you know, concatting the string together with specific identifiers in there, but that gets really ugly too. So most people just simplify them to this, or abstract some of the specific paths to common elements up into a global file that then they can reference on multiple screens. But still, the problem is, it's a string. It tells the compiler nothing. And like I said earlier, the r.id. You know, your element name, as soon as that element name changes for whatever reason, element ID or class, if you're looking by class, now all of a sudden that breaks immediately, so you know that the test needs to be updated. But with a system, with a framework that is based on strings, you don't know that up front. So there's no really refactoring support as well. And can you write them properly? Yes. Does that happen in reality? Usually not. Usually you see a whole bunch of, like, you know, gobbledygook from automatic record in most of the scripts out there. So, so on top of all these things, there's a number of things, like I said earlier, that are challenges in the real world. And so people have found that in order to accomplish those, they need certain things like being able to inject audio and video, images, and things like that at the hardware level, so that the layers of software above the hardware And so, as opposed to injecting it from the framework itself, as opposed to introducing these things from the framework itself and sort of faking it at the top, and then having little or no visibility on how it really works at all the layers of the platform, it's important to be able to simulate some of these things, and that's what Perfecto helps you do. So, boost it for that. But in the meantime, there are a number of things like reporting and collaborative context. What I mean by that, reports matter. Being able to share a URL that has all the detail that you had in the right app, like for instance. Let's see if we can find an example of that or the meta. A report that literally lets you play back what happened. That's context, giving somebody the URL to the report and saying, here's what happened in the CI process. We don't know why. It was your test or it was your component and now it's failing. Being able to actually see that happen and play back and not just as a video file on some server somewhere or on some S3 bucket, but actually having the steps that it's going through, being able to go back and forth. That becomes really useful for that person to very quickly identify what happened. Same thing with network conditions. If all of a sudden there's a spike in memory usage, that's important context to understand why maybe a test was problematic or why there was a piece of functionality that just crashed. So this context really matters. And that's stuff that you're probably going to have to deal with once you start using Espresso as well. So just a shout out to the fact that it's important to get the right kind of context. So learning next steps, and this is where you might want to take a picture. This is definitely where I go after this talk, is there's a whole bunch of stuff I haven't covered, like on data intents. There's idle resources. If you have a reason to custom idle, by idling I mean when you are waiting for some async thing to happen in the background, and then your controls show up again, like if that's an activity that you do, then you're going to potentially need to write something that's custom that waits around for that. And so idle resource is an important part of that. Looking into the Handcrest libraries is also helpful. And this lady is awesome. She is the expert that I would run to if I had some kind of major problem with Espresso. I don't know what's going on or something. She would chin. So she occasionally does a circuit as well. And I would totally have you watch basically all of her advanced Espresso examples once you get past the initial hump for those who are first starter. So the other thing is I can also field some of those questions. So I'd be more than happy to help each and every one of you as you are working through Espresso. And if I can't answer it, we also have somebody in the back who's our director of technology research. And he might be able to help you with something, but then also I can connect you up with somebody who can. At some point, we'll figure it out together. So so there's that. So there's, I saw this in an article, and I think I have the link in the comments, but the taking point, I just want to leave you with a few taking points. And if we're interested in going through the Green Lantern thing, by all means, I'll use the last couple minutes for that. But notice it says, new hires spent a few weeks in support role. Get a better understanding of customer issues, look at the overall process to get software out the door. Like, so that's like onboarding stuff. This was a really good suggestion about how to onboard people to the process. But then it later goes on, and I think this should have been bolded. If you give developers the responsibility not only to land code, but also make sure that it actually works in production, and by that, I infer testing. Because you have to test before you verify that it works in production. That now is a new way to think about what the role is of developing. You're not just shipping features. You're shipping reliable features, features that you can prove work afterwards. That is responsible development. So I thought that was a really great suggestion. And to the point in the back, these will be up and available after the session. I'll hashtag in dev time on Twitter. So the one anecdote from our personal team is at Perfecta we have a team of research, R&D, and new platforms. And one of the really cool things about the guys on the call a couple weeks ago when we were talking about the iOS 10 stuff and where we're supporting it, he said Android is far easier to integrate with. We're in the right room, right? But even if they hardware like audio and video sensors take far less time than iOS.
Their animations have caused my test to break, particularly in line animation, scaling and so forth. So I went out and I found some gists and some Stack Overflow threads about suppressing animation.
Yep.
Try to get them to work.
Yeah, the first thing that the documentation says is, oh, by the way, in your emulators,
right,
whether it's ADD or JennyMotion or whatever, like turn off all the animation.
Right, but it doesn't work for inline. It's a problem. Well, at least with brackets, yeah. So the
has anybody else had to deal with animation problems?
Yeah. So we actually bought them. So
I wound up creating a second app flavor where I could just for that flavors in the configuration, turn the number of repetitions to zero for that particular animation. It only applied it to the particular flavor. So. But it seemed like kind of a hack. And like I said, what I found out there on the web didn't work. So I was wondering if anybody else succeeded.
I don't know, but if you connect with me afterwards, I'll put that on my research log, because I usually spend a couple of hours a week just like researching issues and finding at least the tail end that I can buy into the next thought. So, absolutely. What was your name?
I'm Joel.
Joel. All right. Question. Yes?
Yeah, so
Red?
Cody. So I said, I'm writing a 360 video plan for Android. I thought it was kind of an interesting spot. So when I run it on my device, it's fine. It's such a real path and it looks real fuzzy. When I disconnect it from the device and I relaunch the application, it's because I'm trying to save instant state.
Yep.
So when I try to restore, it's trying to restore the real monitor and it sets the real path to valve and crash.
Yep.
So I was curious about how you write an Espresso test them like that where runs fine one time and crashes the second time based on a relaunch.
Based on a relaunch.
That's too challenging for Espresso, or?
I don't think so. It's a matter of state, though, right?
Yeah.
It's a matter of state. So if your state, Espresso tests require you to launch the app, run the test. That's the workflow.
Right.
It does not allow you necessarily to keep the app run with that state. But on the other hand, there are many screens that allow you to pass in state, that require you to pass in state. And so in your harness for Espresso, if you pass that specific detailing, again, your test is outside of the application. So if you're worried that the application is handling nulls improperly or some input improperly, then you can write a negative test for that. I mean, it's the concept of simply just provide the warped context, the messed up context, and then when your app doesn't crash, you know that it's handled properly, or when it handles it properly, you can test for that. So that's essentially, it's like, I would think that it might be a negative testing situation that might help you.
Well, this one's a little unusual because I have an exit content and it actually kills the process. It actually kills the activity of the process, and then when I rewatch it, it's crash.
Yep. Crash. So the idea is try to automate everything, right? And you can't test all the things. Right? Don't do that. That's a bad idea. Right? You try to do as much as you can, right? Reasonably. And in some cases, like I was talking with one of the Google guys that works on one of the apps, it's like I'm at 20% test coverage. Because what we're doing with, I think it was a VR PR situation is so elaborate, so complicated, that there's very little way to be able to automate that task. So I'm going to say, like, you can always automate this stuff. There's probably a way around. There's got to be a way around. At worst, you can just relegate yourself to that. And there might be some things that you can do with a different task framework, but still is compatible with your platform. But we would like to drill into that. Get the
pretension. It's kind of personal for me. Sending it off to you to show you what kind of software I wrote.
Of course, that happens all the time. So for the one person who voted for Green Lantern, we can go through that individually, but there is one question on the back, and I would prefer to.
Yeah, it might be silly. I was just wondering how people arrive at that number of 20% coverage.
This was just an anecdote from a story, like, they're just like,
In general, like, how can you say, oh, I've written all these tests, and so now I know I have 33.7% coverage? Is it like an estimate, or is there like
a way of saying? There is some test coverage stuff that you can work with in Espresso. We can take that offline. But generally speaking, it's you use metrics, like, for instance, unit testing. It's often really good to identify test coverage over, like, lines of code, over modules and lines of code at that level. When it comes to UI testing, if you think about, people like to say risk-based testing is a bad thing, but in reality, what else do we have? We prioritize what we cover based on a set of dynamic business conditions, whether that's the importance of a workflow, whether that's new functionality, always has to be shipped out the door. So that is a good question. I think it depends on what framework you use and how your team has decided how to quantify what coverage means across. They want to go all the way down every little control, or whether it's every screen, there's ways to do that. So. All right, well, it's now at 9:45. I really appreciate your time, and thank you so much for the questions. And please, if there are things that you still have questions about, please reach out to me on Twitter or by email, or just me at pause.